Greetings, friends. So glad you chose to join us again here at Christ Church, where Pastor James Davis is going to deliver a powerful word from God. So I pray now that this word impact and change your life. Prepare your hearts now to be blessed by the word of God.
I want to get into the word of the Lord today from the book of John, chapter 21 is where I want to go to on this morning. Praise God, and I guess my subject. I'm not going to be before you long. I want to preach from the subject this morning. Amen. Are you gone fishing? Amen. It's a question. Are you gone fishing? Huh? Yeah, 2 weeks. But I think some people already gone. They already gone. You got to be careful. We're dealing with after the resurrection of Jesus Christ, it's not going to the mountain. We used to go up to when we were, our retreats was held like when we were at the Silver Bay. My group, the group that I would lead, would always do the, we would call the mount, we would do the mountain trek. And what we would do, that wanted to go with me, we would go up the mountain. Amen. It was a mile hike up the mountain. Going up the mountain was not the problem. You know, we had to help some folks up that couldn't make it, and we would push them and pull them to get them up to the mountain if they wanted to go. Because once you got to the mountain, up on the top of the mountain where we would stop at, you could look down over the facilities up and down Lake George, and usually the Lord would meet us up there in nature. We get up there, most of the time we'd be up there, all of a sudden it would be quiet, and you know, many times we'd get up there and the Lord would just send a smooth breeze. You could hear the Holy Spirit whispering, and the first time that we went up there, and the Lord did that. Amen. We were up there, and we were above, there was a red-tailed hawk that was flying down. He was below us, and when we seen him. But then the Lord just sent a smooth breeze that, I mean, just came in. It was no breeze, but it came in. It was supernatural. We looked at one another, we prayed, and we went down because we knew it was an encounter with the Lord. And I encourage everyone that went up the mountain with us. The problem was not going up. And they were panting. They would gag and, you know, tell them to take some water. And we pull them and push them to get them up the mountain. Amen. Because we went up where the water had ran down, you know, the mountain. And so we went up that because there were rocks and so forth they could use to, you know, get up there. Brother Smith, you went 1 year. Yes, sir. Okay. The problem, I would encourage them, is not going up. The problem is coming down. Amen. Because coming down, because you're not facing resistance, the tendency is to let the incline of the mountain take you down instead of you walking down. And so we encourage them to certainly be careful coming down, because there where you can sprain an ankle, you can break a leg, because, you know, you ain't exerting no effort. Oh, praise God. Amen. You're just coming down. Amen. Really, gravity, per se, is pulling you down. Oh, praise God. Amen. I say that to tell you, as we come out of this most holy week, this most holy time of the year of believers, the time where we celebrate, amen, the greatest event that ever happened, amen, in the world, amen, that's what I want to preach about this morning. Y'all thought it was tough on the other side of Christ coming to the cross. that was not really the difficult part, amen, as far as the disciples was concerned. The difficult part was after, amen, all of this has happened, amen, what happens next? A service like this where the presence of God is here, amen, when you go home and when you leave this service, amen, I certainly want to pray for you because I don't want you to go into a sphere of depression. Amen. Once you've experienced the goodness of God, amen, then you can't stay there. Not that you can't, but most of us don't stay there. You got to deal with coming down. And if you're not careful how you deal with coming down, you can lapse into a spirit of depression, which will catapult you back before where you ever came. Praise God. Amen. And so our lesson today, John chapter 21, let's read a few verses. I read from the Amplified, verse 1 began. It says, after this, and you can find what he's talking about, amen, by going back to chapter 20, the last two verses, amen, if you just allow me to just go back to those last two verses in chapter 20, amen, which were connected, verse 30 and 31. Verse 30 of chapter 20 says, and there are many other signs and miracles which Jesus performed in the presence of the disciples, which are not written in this book. Amen. So their experience of God, y'all, all of them is not written in the book. Praise God. But the Bible said, but these are recorded in order that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the anointed one, the Son of God, and that through believing and cleaving to and trusting and relying upon him, you may have life through in his name, through who he is. You can have life through who he is. And so the whole purpose of John writing this, amen, so that we could have life through his name. Now, everything about him was not written.
Amen.
Oh, praise God. Amen. But there was enough information given, amen, so that you can have life through his name. Sometimes I get on Sister Davis, and she probably, she probably don't mind me saying it. I'm going to speak ahead to her, so condition her thought process. But sometimes, you know, in speaking with someone, I caution her that she gives too much information. Amen. See, you only need enough information to deal with what you're dealing with.
Right.
Oh, praise God. Amen. You don't need to know other stuff. Oh, praise God. Amen. I gave y'all too much information because I addressed the weather. Amen. The weather has nothing to do with the preaching. But it did tie us together. Come on, y'all. Amen. It has nothing to do with what I'm going to preach about. Oh, praise God. Amen. I want to give you things that pertain to your life that will help you in your life, that you can walk, amen, in life, that you need to know some stuff about you, about life. I love God because God, the Bible said, he did not leave us without a witness. Come on, y'all. Amen. And so there's a witness here. Amen. I don't know what you're facing, what you're going through. Praise God. But God has already settled your problem. Your problem has already been taken care of. All you got to do is acknowledge, amen, him and find out, well, Lord, where's that answer at? And I'm going to tell you, sometimes all you got to do is be quiet to hear God. Amen. But our problems, most of the time, we know everything. But that's another teaching. Amen. Listen to the Bible. John chapter 21, verse 1. He said, after this, Jesus let himself be seen and reveal himself again to the disciples. Notice who he's dealing with. John chapter 20, verse 3 and 31. It says he was dealing with the disciples. He gave them, they had enough evidence. Come on, y'all. Amen. They had enough evidence in order, amen, to carry out the mission that they were assigned. Oh, praise God. Amen. They had enough. Hallelujah. Amen. They had enough. They did not need no more. Could he have given them more? Yes, he could have. Amen. But he gave them enough. Amen. It says at the Sea of Tiberias, and he did it in this way. And then it started to outline, amen, that this is in this time Jesus want to reveal himself again, but not because they never seen him. Come on, y'all, amen. But he wanted to make sure. Hallelujah, amen. And so he came back again. Y'all remember he revealed himself, amen, to Mary, amen, after at the tomb, she thought it was a gardener. He revealed himself to the two disciples on the Emmaus Road, amen. Then he revealed himself, amen, to all of the disciples, amen, in the upper room, amen, Thomas being absent, but then he revealed himself, Thomas was present. Yes. Oh, praise God. Amen. And so, God wants to make sure you get the word. The one thing that I learned about God, God is a God who constantly repeats the same truth over again. Oh, praise God. Amen. God continually, but what he does, he repackages it, but it's the same truth. Amen. I've been preaching now since 1971. I had to check with the record keeper. Since 1971. Oh, praise God. How many years is that, y'all? Huh? 41. I've been preaching 41 years. But I yet to preach something, amen, new. What God does, God gives it, God just changes the package on. But amen. But the message don't change. The package changes. Praise God. Amen. Now listen to what the Bible said. And this is what I want to get you to understand. It says there, and you remember my subject, are you gone fishing? All right. And verse 2 said, there were together Simon, Peter, and Thomas, called the twin, and Nathanael from Cana of Galilee, also the sons of Zebedee, and two other of his disciples. Amen. God is very, I believe every word of God, amen, is inspired. Hallelujah, amen. And so you said, what difference does it make? Well, it made some difference because one of the difference what this scripture shows you, amen, is that who all was there with Peter, amen. And it uses Peter, amen, because of the next statement that's going to be said, hallelujah, Peter was the influential person in this group. Amen, the group consisted of seven persons. Y'all know that there were 12 disciples. One had died, so now it was 11. But here you have the majority, seven, y'all, outside of 11, amen, you only had four that were someplace else. Uh-huh. So you had a quorum, a majority here, amen, that whatever they did, they would set the precedent for the rest of the group. Come on, y'all. Amen. Now listen to what Peter said. Amen. Verse number 3. Simon Peter said to them, I am going fishing. He did not, I'm going fishing. And they said to him, he didn't ask them to come. Y'all got to look at it. He didn't ask them to go, but they said to him, and we are coming with you. So they went out and got into the boat. And throughout the night, they caught nothing. All right. Okay. They caught nothing. And as I meditated on, Lord, this season and what you have done, you know, I wanted to see, Lord, this is momentous of you having the whole world and wanting me. And I couldn't really grasp that, right? Really can get my mind around that. But I said, you love me so much until you sent your only son, you know, who gave his life for me. Oh, praise God, just for me. Yeah. Hallelujah. And I looked at it, and then what's next? Amen. What's after the triumph entry? What's after the crucifixion? What's after the resurrection? Praise God. And that's why I ask y'all the question, are you gone fishing? Praise God. Because it doesn't matter what has taken place until you internalize it and make it personal to you. Oh, y'all ain't saying nothing. Oh, praise God. Amen. See, that can be a lot of money in the world, but until it's my money, come on, y'all. I don't care about it. Hallelujah. The only money that I care about is the money that's mine. Sister Carrie Ann can have $1 million, but that's her money. It don't help me. So I ain't gonna worry about it. Amen. Now, I will start worrying about it when she share a little of it with me. Oh, praise God. Amen. Now I've got something to start occupying my time with, because now, y'all, it's become personal. Hallelujah. Amen. And see, that's the thing that we need to understand, amen, about Christ and about this lifestyle. Amen. And if it's not personal, y'all, amen, really, you gone fishing. Come on. You gone fishing. Amen. And they said, we're going fishing. Now, understand something else. We hold Peter responsible, but everybody had received the same word. Amen. Because Jesus told all of them, amen, to go, amen, to Galilee and wait there until you receive the promise of the Father, which said he, you have heard of me. Oh, praise God. In other words, what Jesus said, God ain't through with you yet. Hallelujah. Amen. And y'all need to know God ain't through with you yet. But I want you to notice, amen, the problem in this, amen, that a lot of y'all know that God has said something to you, and you know, amen, I don't know whether you know or not that God ain't through with you, and some of y'all have gone fishing. You've gone fishing. Praise God. The words that the Lord have left you, amen, you know them, but you have not internalized them. You have not made them personal. Oh, praise God. Amen. And so if you have not personalized what God has said, then you are gone fishing. Now listen to what happened. Amen. Amen. When Peter went fishing, the other thing that happened, whatever you say, you're going to influence somebody.
That's right. Amen.
Mm-hmm. You've got influence. Oh, praise God. All of a sudden, Ella Oliver said, well, said to, he ain't really... Just said in their hearings that Ella, Steve and Ella Nova's heard you. Ella Oliver said, man, I don't think I'm coming the other night, tomorrow night. I don't think I'm going to be there. Amen. He ain't got to ask them to come with him. Amen. But what he sets up in their mind is a thought process, amen, to go where he's going. Your words are powerful. Well, praise God. Amen. And that's why the Bible said that life and death is in the power of the tongue. Oh, praise God. That's why you need to be careful about what you say. You need to be careful of how you talk around your children. Amen. But you need to be careful how you talk anyhow. Amen. Praise God. Hallelujah. Our generation today is the product of what they heard from the older generation. Oh, praise God. Amen. Because maybe not meaning to, but you influence people. Praise God. You influence people, especially if you're a leader, you influence people.
Amen.
If people look up to you, you influence people. Oh, praise God. Amen. You influence people, y'all. You don't have to influence. You don't have to tell them to come, but just who you are. A mother, by her statements, automatically influences her daughters. That's why she can't make flippant statements. Oh, praise God. Amen. Because her daughters will catch that statement. Come on, y'all. Amen. Amen. And no mother might not act it on her. The daughters might act on what mama said. You got to be careful of what you're saying. Amen. And so Peter did, maybe he didn't mean to, but he said it. Now, why did he say that? He said that because he was just on a high. I've talked to people who have been addicted to crack cocaine. And I use that word sparingly when I say addicted, because they're really not addicted. When we speak of addiction, amen, we're speaking of something, amen, that controls your physical body. Are y'all with me? Oh, praise God. See, heroin becomes addictive. Oh, praise God. Because if you once you start having it, when you don't have it, your body will tell you. Amen. And what happens is your body wants it. And if you're going to live with your body, you're going to, oh, come on, y'all. You're going to satisfy your body. After that, you can't take your own body. But see, the difference between heroin and crack cocaine does not affect you physically. What crack cocaine does is affects your mind. And what it does is when you don't have it, the idea, amen, of the last high it took you on will drive you insane. But physically, you're okay. But it's just your mind. Your mind goes. Hallelujah. Oh, praise God. Amen. You don't have to have it. But your thought process makes you want it. Because it takes you back in your past. Hallelujah. When you did have it and when you didn't care about nothing. And it's that feeling, it's that sensation that makes you go back and get more. Simon Peter was a fisherman. Y'all knew Peter. The Lord had called him from this kind of work. When God had called him, he called him from this kind of work. Also understand, amen, it wasn't tomorrow after. I can understand. That's why the laws are so state, y'all. If you purchase something, you got 3 days to rescind that purchase agreement. Amen. If you was pressured into it. Hallelujah. The laws, I know in this state, you got 3 days of rescinding. That you can say, okay, I made a mistake. I don't want it. Take your stuff back. Praise God. This wasn't 3 days. This is 3.5 years. Amen. After he had walked with Jesus, come on, y'all. Amen. He had seen all of the good things that God had done. He was personally affected because when Jesus came to his mother's house, his mother-in-law was sick with a fever, and Jesus healed her. He was a recipient, y'all, amen, of the blessings of God. Amen. He received things from God. So I'm not dealing with a novice. But I'm dealing with somebody that knows. Praise God. And he uses this one statement. He said, I'm going fishing. 3.5 years. What was wrong with that statement? What's wrong with it, amen, is because he did a simple little word, y'all, that y'all do not like. It's called he became disobedient because God told them to go to Jerusalem, amen, and wait there until you get the gift. So far, they did not receive the gift, but he's not, amen, he didn't go to Jerusalem. Where did the Bible say they are at? They're here at Galilee, the Sea of Tiberias. Come on, y'all. He's in a wrong location. Oh, praise God. He said, wrong location. Number two, y'all, he makes a decision out of himself, out of his own mind. He said, I'm going fishing. And as I give you this word, I want you to ask yourself the question, am I going fishing? Praise God. Amen. He went fishing. Hallelujah. And what happened? The Bible says, amen, the rest of them, And you know, this is the thing about sin. I might with sin if I could keep it isolated. But you need to understand that your sin will always involve others. Oh, praise God. Amen. What Peter did, it involved the rest of them. Whether you want to or not, amen, I dealt with this person once, and they said, I'm no leader. I said, by the fact that you told me that God called you, you're a leader. I don't care whether you want to be or not, but you said God called you. Amen. That alone puts you in a position, amen, where the people can look at you. if you don't want nobody to look at you, amen, you need to go back to God and say, God, can you rescind your call? Oh, come on, y'all. Amen. This is every day. This is living every day. Amen. And so nobody, y'all, have anything up on anyone else. It's just like you having your boss on your job and your boss tell you, well, you can't come to me for no end question. Wait a minute. You are the boss. Any problems I have, amen, you're the ones that, amen, I'm to go to. Now you're telling me I can't go to you? What's wrong with this picture? We just left Memphis, all right? Inadvertently, I left a handicap sticker in the rental car. I called back and I says, did y'all find the handicap sticker? And the person said, yes. And I said, well, can you send it to me? No, we can't do that. I said, can I talk to your boss? The boss got on the phone. Well, we don't do that. Sister Davis got on the phone. What you mean you don't do that? My sticker. What you mean I don't do that? Yo, we'll pay you the money if it's a matter of postage. It's going to cost you 45 cents. And what you mean? I can understand it's not company policy, but Sister Davis, do you got 45 cents? Buy a stamp. He wanted us to buy a stamp, self-addressed envelope, and send it to him. So you want me to spend 90 cents when it only can cost you 45 cents? And so he eventually said, well, it's not company policy for us to do it. And so we found a guy, he finally said, the sister said, well, what you need? You need $1, $2? I mean, yo, it's a regular envelope. Can you just put it in a regular envelope? And the point that I'm bringing, he eventually said that he was sinning. I don't know how he's going to pay for it. Hopefully, I don't have to take out a loan. You understand what I'm saying? Amen. But the person, amen, who answered the phone, amen, would not give any resolve to it. Said, "Cause it's company policy, we don't do it." I understand that. But everybody got a boss. Come on, y'all. If I can't get no satisfaction from you, I want to talk to your boss. Amen. That's a piece of information that will bless y'all. Amen. Don't stand up there and argue with the clerk. Amen. Call the boss. Oh, praise God. Call the boss. Hallelujah. Praise God. Amen. And so it's just life, y'all. It's just life. Praise God. Amen. So Peter was in a position, y'all, of influence. Amen. And so him say, I'm going fishing. Praise God. It affected the rest of the six that was with him. What am I saying, y'all, amen, if Sister Barbara Baker, amen, has relationship with Sister Diane, you know, the second one, Robert, with Diane Roberts, she got relationship, and they talking all the time. I'm going to show you this, amen. And Barbara Baker says, they're talking, so Barbara Baker said to Diane, she said, well, tomorrow's service. And said, but I don't, she didn't tell her not to go, but she said, well, I don't think I'm going tomorrow. And this is why I'm not going. Previous to our conversation, Diane Roberts was going to go. But what Barbara Baker planted in Diane's mind was the thought of not going. Amen. And so Diane Roberts would come up with a reason why not to. The chances are, amen, the chances are, amen, better than normal that if Barbara Baker won't come, Diane won't come. I don't know the percentages, but I know they have did studies on that. Amen. It's called the power of influence. Oh, praise God. Amen. And you got influence over somebody. How many people, let me ask y'all this question. Who's here this morning because somebody else came. I'm not trying to put you on the spot, but I mean, are you here because, yeah, you're here because of somebody else. Somebody else? Y'all here because of somebody else? Y'all just don't want to show yourself up. But we're under influence, y'all. Praise God. Amen. We're in the influence. Now, the thing is that happened when they went with him, they got caught into also. They went fishing also with him. But the thing is, what they understood what to do. They knew what to do, y'all. Amen. But they became a failure at what they knew. They became failures at what they knew. Peter was an experienced fisherman. He had done it as a life income. Come on, y'all. But now, amen, that he knew what to do, couldn't do it no more. Couldn't do it no more. Amen. I told you a story before, amen, about our goddaughter. You know, that wanted to, how old was Bria, honey? About 4 years old. Amen. And Micah was born, right. And she seen her little brother, Micah, was a baby. And she seen Micah nursing, and she wanted to nurse. She's about 4 years, she wanted to nurse. The doctor told Sister Blair, said, let her try. Said, go ahead, let her try. What happened was she found out she couldn't nurse because she's 4 years old. She had lost the ability to do what she could do when she was a baby. And she got upset with her mother. That's why couldn't she nurse? But it wasn't her mother's problem. It was her problem. Come on, y'all. Amen. See, when you try to go back to do something that you used to do, you'll find your coordination is off. Oh, praise God. Now, I'm not trying to hurt you. I'm trying to give y'all some fact. See, and that's why the Bible speaks about that once you know Christ, come on, y'all, amen, to go back again. That's the scripture you read this morning in Hebrews. Oh, praise God. See, you can never go back. Because when you go back, a couple of things will happen. Number one, your past is no longer as it was when you were there. So your past will reject you. Oh, praise God. Amen. Yo, I know you used to think that you had it with the girls and so forth. You go back, man, you old. Come on. Come on, y'all. You old. Hallelujah. Amen. You're out of time now. Amen. The things that you, they don't work no more. Oh, praise God. Hallelujah. Amen. And they did this study. The criminal justice has did this study. That's why they know, amen, if a crime is committed, amen, in the vicinity of a person that's been released from jail, they always look for that person. Amen. And what they look for, amen, is where did he used to hang out at? Oh, praise God. Amen. Because, see, if he has not got a vision for his new life, amen, he's going back to try to fit in to his old life. Come on, y'all. Amen. And when you try to fit into your old life, y'all, will reject you. Oh, praise God. See, y'all, please do not take lightly, amen, Christ getting into your life. Because once you taste of Jesus, your life will never be the same again. Amen. You can get upset with me. You can get mad at me. Amen. You can stay home if you want to, but I'm going to pray. Amen. Because I know that your life will never be the same again. Oh, praise God. Amen. And so Peter went back, but he couldn't fish. Here you have an experienced fisherman. He can't fish. It's like having an experienced chef and no longer can cook. I know the ingredients. I got all the stuff that I need, but it ain't coming out right. Praise God. Why? Gone fishing. Hallelujah. Gone fishing, y'all, is evidence of a person leaving what God has called you to do. Gone fishing means you are off track. Yeah, have you ever noticed on a store, on any store, amen, we've seen it common, you know, in the country you see it. You don't see it too much right here, but they put a sign in the window. Amen. They don't say closed. They say gone fishing. Oh, praise God. Amen. Because closed is saying something else. Right. Gone fishing says I've got tied up of stuff and I need some time for myself. I need to think. I need to go out there and chill. Come on, y'all. Amen. See, I'm going to talk to y'all this morning because, see, the problem is that we got a lot of people that they chilling. They gone fishing. Oh, praise God. They gone fishing. Amen. And I'm here to rattle your cage. Hallelujah. Amen. If you have not dropped your net yet, I'm here to rattle your cage. Amen. To come back and do what you were called to do. So they fished all night. Throughout the night, the Bible said they caught nothing. They caught nothing. They became a failure. Hallelujah. See, y'all, I understand construction. Praise God. Amen. I know how to work on houses and all of that kind of stuff. Oh, praise God. Amen. I know how to do it. And I know, amen, that if I went back fishing, amen, I know I can make a good living, praise God, in the housing market. I'm saying a good living. But I know also, amen, the Lord already let me know if I do that, I'm gone fishing. And what I know to do, amen, that I will not be able to do it because that's not his call and will on my life at this time. Some of y'all have gone fishing. God has did some awesome stuff in y'all life, amen, but y'all gone fishing. Praise God. Because I talked to the Lord about this word. I said, Lord, what about? He said, tell my people, amen, they gone fishing. Amen. And I did not send them fishing. Come on, y'all. Why are they fishing? Because of their own mind. They thought about it and it was what they decided to do. Whenever you make a decision to do something outside of the will of God, you will catch nothing. Gone fishing. There are people who are pursuing other goals in education and other stuff like that. But God said, you gone. And the end result says, God said, you will catch nothing. If the Lord does not tell you, don't do it. Don't go. Praise God. Amen. God was very merciful, amen, to them. So look at verse number 5, and I'm coming to a close because I'm not going to finish this today. Amen. Verse number 5. So Jesus, amen. Look at verse 4. It said, verse 4 said, morning was already breaking when Jesus came to the beach and stood there. However, the disciples did not know that it was Jesus. He had been with them 3.5 years. Come on, y'all. Amen. What if I went away from Sister Davis for a few weeks, a few months, you know, and come back and ring the doorbell and she want to know who's that? I think I would have a slight attitude problem. I'm going to be honest with you. I really would have a slight attitude problem. Oh, praise God. Amen. And here, amen, Jesus had not been gone for them, y'all. He only stayed on the earth 40 days, amen, after he was risen. So at the most it could have been was 40 days. They had been with him 3.5 years. How could he stand on the shore and they not know him? They don't know him. Why? Their mindset was gone fishing. And when your mind is gone, my God, it cuts you away from what you should know. You become, my words are, you become dumb and stupid when you go fishing. They didn't know him. After all he had did for them, they did not know him. Praise God. When you go fishing, you lose your recognition of Jesus. And you no longer know him. Praise God. Amen. Verse 5. So Jesus, here's where mercy comes in. I tell you, y'all, if it wasn't for the mercy and the grace of God, we'd be messed up. Here's where mercy comes. Jesus did not have to do what he did. But verse 5 says, so Jesus said to them, boys, children, there's many words for that, but boys, children, you do not, he asked some questions, you do not have any meat, any fish, do you? He asked them a question. It's in the form of a question. In other words, y'all didn't get nothing, did you? He's telling them. You might say he's rubbing it in. And sometimes God will rub in your mess ups. You knew that you messed up. And sometimes God will rub it in. Amen. In other words, what he's saying, have you caught anything to eat along with your bread? Hallelujah. Y'all got some meat with the bread. And they answered him, no. I don't know whether the attitude was with that no or not. But listen, you've been there all night. Frustration caused you to respond many times how you were not normal. Have anybody ever got frustrated? Come on, y'all. You all want to deal with people when you're frustrated. Oh, praise God. You did all of that. Woman come over and try to cook dinner, right? And everything messed up. Now her husband come home ready to eat. And the dinner was burned up. And then he asked a question, is dinner ready? That no got attitude to it. No, and he had nothing to do with it. He had nothing to do with him. But it was, y'all call it was one of those days. Amen. Seems like everything messed up. And now he comes on. Here's my lover, the love of my life. He comes home. Working all day. You knew he was coming home. And you had told him I was going to fix dinner. He Sabbathed for dinner. And dinner ready yet? He's all happy and so forth. Amen. And that resounded no. No explanation. I had enough of that. Yeah, this is a no with attitude. Amen. Somebody ever, you ask them a question and they give you an answer like that. Understand, that's no with attitude. Amen. They didn't try to justify it because it was no justification. They just said, no. Now look at what he did. And he said to them, and this really can, I won't use, but this can tee you off. All right? When you know what to do, and you did everything what you know to do, and then Mr. Know-It-All shows up. Come on, y'all. Amen. Now, it's not enough that you're frustrated, right? But then Mr. Know-It-All come up. I bet you if you put worms on that hook. Come on, y'all. Hallelujah. Amen. Sometimes Sister Davis does that to me. I know I'm saved because I deal with it. And I swallow hard, but I swallow. Amen. When you're frustrated at doing something you know to do, and then somebody comes up and tell you something, and you know they don't know what you know. Oh, y'all ain't saying nothing. But they got the answer for your problem. Oh, it only me. I'm the only one get affected by it. Oh, the rest of y'all, okay, rest of y'all, okay, fine. Yeah. Sister David, sometimes I want to react a little bit because, you know, I'm frustrated. And Sister Davis would bring a word that I'm not fond of, and she said, "You just stubborn." Because I'll do something else, and you know, you work around the bush to finally get back to. You understand what I'm saying? Yeah. As women has a way of rubbing. Come on, brothers. Y'all can definitely answer me there. Yeah, because see, we as men, we already know that we know what to do. Praise God. Amen. And the best they can do is help us, but they really shouldn't know more than us. You know why? Because we say, yeah, well, like the son said, it's a man's world. Let me pitch it. So we need help. Y'all know we need help. Amen. So y'all pray for us. That's why we need prayer. We definitely need prayer. Prayer. All right. Let me finish this. Let y'all out of here. Praise God. Amen. And so Jesus said to them, "Cast a net on the right side of the boat, and you will find some." So they cast net, and now they were not able to haul it in for such a big catch. A mass quantity of fish was in it. Close the book. Why was that significant? They were fishermen. They had went fishing, right? They knew, right, to catch fish, amen, you've got to be in so much water. Come on, y'all. Amen. We go fishing. Brother Graham is saying that in a few weeks he's gone. 2 weeks. Now, when we go fishing, we're talking deep sea fishing, right? We never get in the boat in the harbor. And the captain says, "Okay, let down your line." We would crucify him. Because normally you do not fish in the harbor. You get out into the water. Because normally that's where the fish, I'm saying normally, that's where the fish is. What's significant about this, that identified Jesus as not only Lord, but also Master and Commander of everything, number one, he asked them to lower their nets in a place where normally there's no fish. Secondly, the fish that they caught were huge fish. Large fish definitely don't come in shallow water. They're not there. How shallow was the water? Amen. It was so shallow when they caught the fish, y'all, they could not lift the net on the boat. They were able to get into the water and drag the net to shore. All right. Come on, y'all. Oh, praise God. Amen. That's what they were able to do. So what the Lord did, y'all, it had to completely change their thinking. And I want to close today, but I want to tell y'all who are gone fishing. You've experienced some highs in God. God has did, Brother Rick, God just, amen, just visited him on last night in a way that he'll be telling for the rest of his life. for him to go fishing. Praise God. Amen. It's really insane. And what I'm telling you, what God has did for you to go fishing now, you have lost your mind. And I know the Bible says in Proverbs chapter 3, verse 6, right? In all your ways, acknowledge him, and he shall direct your path. But you know what you're saying? I direct my own path. I am going my own way. And I'm here to warn somebody today, amen, that the Lord said, you gone fishing and you will not prosper. Because that's not what I told you to do. You notice what God told him. God had told him, go to Jerusalem and wait there until you receive the promise from the Father. It matters not how long you got to wait, but you need to do the first step. First, go. Come on, y'all. Amen. Instead of us going to where God is saying, we're going fishing. You understand that you're in the fork of the road of your life. And the fork, y'all, will take you one way or another way. God has told you what way should go. You should go. It's like the Bible said, you know, what does the Lord require? What does God require? But to do justly. Amen. And to live peaceful with your neighbor. You know what God requires. But you gone fishing. Oh, praise God. Amen. And at the end of your fishing expedition, you're going to find out that you will catch nothing. God wants you to, in his mercy, as he stood on the shore and they didn't know him. So the Lord is standing on the shores of your heart and you have not recognized him. Oh, I know. You've been saying that's Pastor Melon with me. No, it wasn't me. You need to see behind me. It was the Lord. Praise God. You say that I'm 3 times 7. I do whatever I want to do. Gone fishing. You say that nobody got any right to tell me about myself. Gone fishing. I come and go as I please. Gone fishing. So I just want to encourage you today. I don't believe that the Lord gave me that word for nothing, Brother Anthony. I see him yesterday. He said to Pastor, I know you got a word. You stirred something in me. I said, Lord, if you ain't been working with me for a word, you better give me one now. But the Lord had already started seething my heart with the word. Amen. And he said, folks are gone fishing. He said, you want to know why? They don't give me all because they're fishing. Why can't they worship me? They're fishing. Come on, y'all. See, when you go fishing, the store can't open. When you go fishing, you can't serve nobody. Gone fishing, y'all, is you doing that for you. Gone fishing. And so I want to encourage you, amen, if you're gone fishing, you need to drop your nets, you need to drop your poles, and you need to get back and remember, what did God say to me? What did God tell me to do? Because, the thing is, once you experience goodness, you have a tendency to forget what it was to be bad. Once God, once you become a filled, you don't recall hunger. Once you get a few dollars, you really don't recall broke. Come on, y'all. Your whole mentality changes. Hallelujah. And so I want to stir your mind that God brought you from somewhere. Oh, praise God. And you need to know, what did you say to him? Lord, if you get me out of this. Amen. What did you tell him? Some of y'all know y'all was at the point of losing your mind. But now you gone fishing? It's time for you to get back and receive further instructions from the Lord. But there's no time to go fishing. Church, I want to wake you up. There's no time to go fishing. After all this God has done, amen, all over the church world, church, God that bless people, they gone fishing. The Lord, why isn't there some exuberant? God told me, they gone fishing. They gone fishing. They gone fishing. If that's you, if you gone fishing, amen, you need to have a conversation with yourself and with that other fella you call the three of y'all. Y'all need to come in unit, me, myself, and I. Y'all need to have a conference. Amen. Conference with me, myself, and I. Amen. Y'all need to have a conference. And y'all all need to come to agreement. Praise God. Amen. That although I know how to fish, I ain't going fishing because God has called me to do a different kind of fishing. Amen. The Lord don't cause you to lose your skill, but rather he rechallenges. What is it that the Lord have called you for and you are not doing it? Amen. Well, that's all I got. Amen. To go above that would be ludicrous. Amen. So take that word today, y'all. Make sure you're not fishing. Amen. Make sure you're not fishing. It challenged me. It challenged me. Because what it made me look at, Lord, what did you say? And what am I doing that you didn't tell me to do? Praise God. What am I doing that you didn't tell me? Understand this one point, y'all, that doing a right thing, doing a good thing, is not necessarily doing a right thing. It's a difference between right and good. And so many of us are caught up in doing good things, but we've lost doing right things. I want to thank God for the word today and for your patience of sitting to listen to the word of God today, that the Lord might help you, amen, and enable you to do what he has called you to do, and that you might get back on track of your own life. There is blessings in you knowing that I'm on the track that God has put me on. There's a blessing in that, amen. It might not be the same as somebody else. Might be a different track. Amen. All men don't have the same vision. All women don't have the same vision. All marriages don't have the same vision. Amen. Whatever God has for you, amen. The Lord, you know it, and the Lord know it. Amen. You know it, and the Lord know it. You just need to do it. Praise. Just need to do it. Amen. You say, well, Pastor, what's God's will for me? You need to do what you know. And then come see. Because most of the time, you're not doing what you know. Amen. People want to give you, they want higher knowledge and learning, and they won't even utilize that they already know. And I'm going to tell you, amen, when God told you, listen, you need to praise me, amen, you want to know God's will, and then you won't praise God. Well, I want to get closer to God. And then you want to worship him? I mean, y'all, we need to think about some of these things. Because some of these things, y'all, really, when you think about it and analyze it, you crazy for some. You would slap your own self. Come on, y'all. You would slap your own self and say, I've been a fool for asking God for some of these things. Because they're within my control and they're within my power to do it. God will not move into your life until you do everything that you know to do. Lord, I need you to, cleanse me from drugs. Well, you got to stop taking it. I mean, come on. You know, God ain't no genie in the bottle. Well, praise God. Amen. That's not God. Lord, I need you to help me to be able to love Sister So-and-so because she gets on my nerve. Well, you know, you need to get saved. Ooh. And you ain't saved. Praise God. You ain't saved. Because, see, when you get saved, you get the love of Jesus. You get God's spirit that spreads that love throughout your life. Amen. Praise God. And so there's a lot of things we need to do. So
I'm sure this word was a blessing to you today. And I'd like to take this time to welcome you to Christ Church of Albany. And we'd like to invite you to our Sunday morning worship service at 381 Sheridan Avenue. So come and celebrate with us every Sunday morning at 11 a.m. And remember, the Lord is good, his mercy is everlasting, and his truth endures through all generations.